Well, this man who was blaming heredity and died and all that for his colitis, I pointed out to him that the late Dr. Flanders Dunbar, great authority on psychosomatic medicine. She was a medical doctor, psychiatrist, also took degrees in religion because she discovered that a number of people were sick because of false religious beliefs. So I pointed out to him that she was a distinguished authority on it and said that a number of cases of colitis in New York Hospital showed that the men were tied to their mothers, had never been away from their mothers for more than 30 days in their whole lives. None of these men was married, and the onset of their colitis was associated with the conflict between the mother tie and desire for marriage. The man had a similar conflict plus a deep-seated resentment of his mother, who seemed to criticize and find fault with every girl he brought to their house as a prospective bride. It had nothing to do with heredity, had nothing to do with diet. I found that he was deeply in love with a spiritual-minded young woman, but hesitated to marry her, lest he offend and disturb his mother. His eventual solution was simple. He came to a decision to marry. He brought a home for his bride. He broke the umbilical cord once and for all. He radiated love and goodwill to his mother and wished for her all the blessings of heaven. But he informed her that his wife now came first in his life. His ulcerated colitis cleared up miraculously in a few weeks. He had been deceiving himself for several years, failing to see that the cause of his sickness was purely emotional, was due to the poison pocket of resentment and the crevices of a soul. This man did not deliberately give himself colitis. His trouble came from the accumulation of his negative and destructive thinking. Because the subconscious mind is the law, it arranges all the deposited thoughts into a complex pattern. And these constantly fed subconscious patterns are not only the cause of all ills, but also the cause of our successes and triumphant achievements. The great lie is the average man is constantly attributing causation outside himself. He blames conditions, environment, and circumstances. Sometimes he blames God, but all his difficulties are caused by mental patterns and beliefs lodged in his subconscious mind. The great lie, in essence, is the belief in material causation. You will constantly hear people claim that material circumstances are the source of their difficulties, trials, and tribulations. It isn't the thing believed in. If you believe, you know, in a shrine, it isn't the shrine, it's your belief. Nothing to do with the shrine. If you think you bathe in a certain water and you're going to be healed, it's nothing to do with the water. Analyze the water, the same water in your own home. It's the belief, not the thing believed in. So, according to your belief, belief is to live in the state of being, to be alive to something, to accept something as true. So, the object of your fate, be true or false, you'll get results. So, some people say, well, if I touch that bone of that saint, I'll get a healing, all right? So, somebody steals that bone. And they put a dog's bone there. And that person comes and thinks it's still a saint's bone. He'll get results, not because of the bone, it's a dog's bone. No, not because of the bone, but because of his belief. You can call it blind belief if you want to. So it's the belief in his subconscious responds. That's a simple law of life. Why people don't understand that today is beyond my imagination. So you'll constantly hear people say that circumstances, conditions, and all that are the source of their problems and other people. This is the lie of major importance. It must be utterly and completely refuted. While talking with a woman some years ago, I learned her mother had a serious illness, and that, as she said, was a splendid Christian. Most people don't know what that word means anyhow. That she was kind-hearted, religious, and most generous. And why didn't God do something for her? Such a question illustrates perfectly the great lie that affects many people. The law of life is the law of belief. We demonstrate what we believe. You can believe a lie too, you know. Whatever we sow in our subconscious mind, we shall reap. If we sow thoughts of sickness, fear, resentment, and enmity, we shall reap these things. To sow a thought, biblically speaking, means to accept it wholeheartedly. It is our deep-seated beliefs that we demonstrate. What you really believe in your heart, in other words. This girl and her mother were completely deceived in that both of them believed that sickness is independent of the mind, has nothing to do with the thinking process. That's the great lie that Quinby was talking about. The great lie which the whole world believes in, that sickness is out there somewhere, something I catch. That's too stupid for words. Her mother had a bad heart condition and believed that she could not be cured. That was a real belief. And so naturally, she couldn't get a healing. There are no incurable diseases. There are only incurable people. There are those who believe they cannot be healed, and according to their belief, is it done unto them. Her mother made excellent progress as she learned the law of life. As she ceased to be under the spell of the great lie, that her heart is a material object with laws of its own, independent of her thinking. She now believes that her body is subject to her thoughts and feelings. As she changes her mind, so she will change her body. And she is no longer that way. She knows how to pray, prays regularly and systematically, knowing that an infinite healing presence is flowing through her as the beauty of wholeness, vitality, and strength, that God's love dwells in her mind and body. She realized that sickness has no power beyond what she gives it in her own thought, and she found herself healed. When trouble of any kind comes, look upon it as a nature signal that you're thinking wrongly in that direction. Then change your thought and keep it changed. I've heard this expression, "What have I done to deserve this?" was asked recently by a young man, adding, "I have never done anything wrong." The explanation is the cure, as Quinby said in 1847. So I proceeded to point out to this young man that all our experiences are the results of our subconscious beliefs and assumptions. No matter what happens in your life, it is simply an outpouring of your subconscious mind. Out of the heart are the issues of life. The heart means your subconscious mind in Hebrew symbolism. All issues, all experiences, conditions, and events that you experience are a mathematical reproduction of the subconscious patterns, of subconscious beliefs and conditioning. In other words, all the experiences, conditions, and events of our lives are the result of the totality of our beliefs. Moreover, all of us have many beliefs and ideas which we have long since forgotten, perhaps going back to childhood, hidden in the deeper recesses of our subconscious mind. All our beliefs and tendencies with which we were born are still with us, and they have power to manifest in and influence our lives. For example, if you believe that sitting near a fan will give you a stiff neck, your subconscious mind will see to it that you get a stiff neck, not because of the fan, which represents innocuous molecules of energy oscillating at a higher frequency, but because of your erroneous beliefs. I've seen people in India operate working under a fan all day, and it has no effect whatever upon them. The fan is harmless. Surely you don't say the fan gives you a stiff neck. It's molecules moving in space. If you're afraid that you will catch a cold because someone sneezes, your fear is a movement of your own mind, which creates what you expect, fear, and believe. Others in the office don't get a cold. When the virus comes around, there are many men and women in your office, in your factory. They'd never get in. They don't believe in it. They believe in health. If you happen to be in a warm room and you go out in the cool atmosphere, nature may cause you to sneeze. That's nature's way of bringing about a balance, an equilibrium in your body. The sneeze is a blessing. It's a benediction. Many, however, fear that they are now catching a cold, not knowing that it is the creative power of their own thought that caused the cold. This young man, who wondered what he had done to deserve such trouble, confessed to me that he had bought an astrology magazine that morning, and it said that there was great danger of an automobile accident, to be very careful. He said that he was charged with fear and shook all over when he read it. He didn't want to drive that day, but he had to go for an audition, which was very important, and the only way was by car. He had three accidents that same day, injuring one man seriously. He was suffering from shock himself, and also received some contusions and lacerations. His car was badly damaged. Job said, "What I greatly feared has come upon me." It had nothing to do with the stars, the Mercury and Venus and Harmony and Saturn. They're all molecules moving in space like your Earth. Nothing evil in this universe. God pronounced everything good and very good. Why should we have the effrontery, the audacity, the impertinence to pronounce certain things evil when God pronounced them good and very good? Nothing good or bad, but thinking makes it so. His great fear brought on these accidents, thoughts which are emotionalized and are dramatized into experience by the subconscious mind. His subconscious mind took his great fear as a request and manifested it on the screen of space. What we sow, we shall surely reap. There's only one power. That's the spirit within you. You call it consciousness, which is the way you think, feel, believe, which you give mental consent to. There's no other power or cause or substance in the universe. I gave this man a prayer to use regularly and elaborated on the point that if he filled his mind with these great truths, his subconscious mind would accept them accordingly, and he would be under a subconscious compulsion to drive harmoniously and peacefully, that nothing would ever happen to him again. This is the prayer I gave him, suggesting that he use it regularly and systematically until it became a part of him, just like an apple becomes your bloodstream. The same way you learn to walk, to swim, to dance, to play the piano, to type. You repeat a thought pattern, act again and again. After a while, it was second nature, an automatic response of your deeper mind to your conscious thinking and acting. That's prayer. When you type, you're praying. When you drive a car, you're praying. You're conforming to principles. The wheels have to be round. The gas won't drive your car. It has to change its consistency and become a vapor. Likewise, in order for your world to change, you have to change your mind. You can't go on thinking the same old way. In order to begin to think in a new way, you have to get some new ideas. You have to find out about the laws of mind. You have to get a read for your new thinking. And you therefore you begin to think in whatsoever things are true, lovely, noble, and godlike. You realize that your thoughts are creative. Whatever you impress in the subconscious, good or bad, is expressed. Therefore, you begin to have a healthy, reverent, wholesome respect for your thoughts. And there's a reason for your thinking then. So this man began to affirm, this is God's car, his own car. It's God's idea, of course it is. Where did it come from? It moves from point to point freely, joyously, and lovingly. God's wisdom guides this car in all its ways. God's order, symmetry, beauty govern the mechanism of this car at all times. God's holy presence blesses this car and all its occupants. The driver of this car is an ambassador of God. He's full of love and goodwill to all. God's peace, truth, and understanding always govern the driver. God directs all decisions, making straight, beautiful, and perfect the way. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon the driver, making all roads a highway for his God. Wonderful prayer. There are many people who blame the weather for their cold, aches and pain, also for their depression, melancholia. They say, well, also they say, he's blocking my good. You know, only for that fellow in the office I'd be promoted. You're making a god of another person. That's the big lie. There's only one God. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God. Jealous in the sense you mustn't know another, because then your mind is double-minded. You're unstable. You're pressing up and down on the elevator. We don't know what you believe in. There's only one power. So you don't put another person on a pedestal and say, you're a new God, I've got to worship. You're blocking my good. Now, how on earth can you make any sense out of that? There's only one being at the infinite presence and power within you. There's nothing to oppose that. It's omnipotent, the creed of the world. Nothing, none shall stay its hand and say unto it, what doest thou? No one can oppose it. All-powerful, the ever-living one. And therefore, you say to yourself, if you want promotion, infinite spirit opens up a new door for me where I express myself at my highest level. And where I exercise my faculties at the highest degree. And I have a marvelous and wonderful income, consistent with integrity and honesty. So promotion is mine. Then you realize the power of the Almighty is backing you up. You go to the source. Stop believing in that big lie. The whole world believes a lie. It's so true. So the air, as we said, is harmless. Stop polluting the atmosphere with strange notions, false doctrines, and weird beliefs. People talk about pollution, but you never hear them talk about the pollution of the mind, with resentment, hostility, and anger, and hate, and all this sort of thing. You must learn the great truth that no person, situation, or condition causes you to be ill, unhappy, lonesome, or to suffer from pecuniary embarrassment. So there's no use blaming somebody else. No one to blame at all. The beliefs and impressions made in your subconscious mind cause all your experiences and events of your life. Someone can call you a skunk. Well, are you going to get angry and upset? Can't you say, God's sister, you have no power to disturb me today. God's peace filled your soul. Or you can say to yourself, God loves me and cares for me. And go on about your business, can't you? Now, don't tell me that person has power to disturb you. If so, you're suffering from the great lie, as the biggest lie of all time. The suggestions, statements of others have no power to disturb you. You know that very well, except you're a mental case. You can curse or bless. It's the movement of your own mind, and there's no law preventing you from saying, God loves me and cares for me. You neutralize that negative thought or that angry thought. You make constructive energy out of it, don't you? You must learn the great truth. No person, situation, or condition has any power to disturb you. Billions are suffering from the great lie because they're self-hypnotized by an accumulation of false ideas, beliefs, opinions, and sense evidence. Your subconscious mind acts as law to manifest and portray the accumulated patterns which are dwelling in your deeper mind. Nothing happens by chance. Everything is pushed from behind, as Emerson said. Psychiatrists and psychologists, medical doctors, delving and probing into your deeper mind, have demonstrated that you're not aware of these inner patterns. Not having placed them there knowingly, many persons assume that they do not have them. Then they establish alibis and excuses of all kinds to justify themselves. Quimby proved 100 years ago that the body moves as moved upon. The body acts as acted upon. That it has no volition, no self-conscious intelligence, no activity of itself. The body doesn't catch disease. That's insanity. The body is characterized by inertia. You can see your body in waves of light, molecules moving at tremendous speed. You can play in your body a melody of God or a hymn of hate. The body doesn't care. It's characterized by inertia. It's an emotional disc upon which you play your emotions. If you sever, as I explained to you previously, sever a part of your body, you can suffer from disease, undergoes decomposition. I'd like to reiterate that because it's so true. Therefore, you know very well all disease takes place in the mind, and disease is lack of ease, lack of poise, lack of peace. That's why you read in the Bible all the time. He said, go in peace, thy faith had made thee whole. Why in peace? Because their mind was in turmoil, in sixes and sevens. They were emotionally disturbed, overwrought, maybe jealous, envious, hateful, whatever it might be. But they had no peace of mind. If they had peace of mind, they couldn't be sick. Don't you know this? It's impossible to have a healthy mind in a sick body. Mens sana in corpore sana. A healthy mind, a healthy body. Very simple, isn't it? Very simple. The great lie operates from many angles. There are those who blame the devil for their problems, but there's no such being. Do you know what the Hebrews give that title for? Ayin. It means the eye. For the eye slays the fact. Your eye deceives you. Say the sun, the earth moves around the sun, or the earth, is flat or something of that nature. Your eye deceives you. So they call the devil the eye, ayin. And they also called it laughter, mirth, because there's no such being. They said the devil has got upside down. The morbid, twisted, distorted concept that people have of God of love, to the fraud I am fraud, to the pure I am pure. There's only one power. There can't be two or three or 1,000. Just one. That's the greatest of all truths, Devil, E-D-I-L, spell it backwards, L-I-V-E, all right. If you're living life backwards, that's your evil or your devil, isn't it? In Hebrew, Satan, in the book of Job, Seta, means to slip, to err, to deviate from the truth, all right. Surely that's your devil, isn't it? When you deviate from the truth, when you misuse the law, it's misunderstanding, misinterpretation of life, wherever the universal presence and power diversifies itself, it limits itself. So we see through a glass darkly. So it's your misunderstanding is the only devil there is, or you could call it ignorance, another word for it. Buddha called it ignorance. So it means living life backward, like spell live backward, and that's what you have. The ancient Hebrew mystics said that the devil is one who lies about God, the slanderer, One who slanders or tell lies about the truths of the infinite. Good and evil are simply the movements of your mind, relative to the living spirit within you, which is God, of course. The forces of nature are not evil. It depends entirely on the use we make of the elements of nature and the forces within us, whether we have a constructive or a negative reaction. The great lie is to enthrone the idea in your mind that things, conditions, and phenomena are the determining causes of your misery, suffering, and misfortune. It's the biggest lie of all time. There is no one to change but yourself. And you are your own savior. To think that some man is going to save you is the biggest lie in the world. Because your Bible tells you point blank, I rejoice in God my Savior. And there's only one God, there can't be two gods or two powers, impossible, spiritually, mentally, or any other way. And I said, ye are gods, and all of your sons are the Most High, everybody's a son of God. As they were all expressions of the one being, the one progenitor. So stop giving power to people, conditions, and events. So a man, a banker, said to me one time that members of his staff were out due to a virus infection. that he was afraid of catching it also. He wanted to know how to protect himself. I replied, telling him that he was afraid of an invisible virus which he couldn't see. It had no power over him. I pointed out that he was suggesting to himself that he might be liable to the infection, that the suggestions and statements of others had no power to create the things they suggest. They don't. The power is in you, the movement of your own thought. Choose ye this day whom will serve. Hold before you this day a blessing and a curse, a blessing if you obey the law, a curse if you disobey. Suggestions of others are powerless. I told him to reject the suggestion of infection completely, that the creative action is always in his own thought and feeling. I also pointed out that nothing can happen to him except through the creative power of his own mind, that others, therefore, had no power. He affirmed frequently as follows, I and my Father are one. I live now and have my being in God. God lives, moves, and has being in me. God can't get sick, you know. The Spirit was never hurt or wounded. What is true of God is true of me. God can't be sick. Therefore, I can't be sick. I am all health. God is my health. Health is mine. Joy is mine. Peace is mine. I feel wonderful. You can rest assured he had no flu. You're in charge of your own mind, and you have the wonderful opportunity to affirm that God's peace and love fills your heart and your mind and your whole being. The power is always in you. Not in the other. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. I am the Lord, that is my name. My glory you shall not give to another, neither shall you give my praise. And I am the Lord, and there is none else. And from the rising of the sun to the setting of the same, there is none else. And when you say I am, you're renouncing the presence and power of God within yourself. Pure being, life awareness. That's the only presence, power, cause, and substance. The big lie is to give power to any person, place, or thing, germ, or circumstance, or condition. Then you're no longer loving the one, the beautiful, and the good. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Cease giving power and prerogatives to people, conditions, and events which have no power. Cease looking upon matter as evil or the world as evil. Spirit and matter are one. Matter is the lowest degree of spirit, and spirit is the highest degree of matter. Matter and invisible energy are one. Scientists inform us that energy and matter are interchangeable. Energy and matter are one. This is why thoughts are things. Thought is cause, the manifestation of the effect. Let us have a wonderful prayer. And prayer changes things. It changes the person who prays. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? This one verse of the 27th Psalm gives you personal freedom from all fear. It reveals to you the source of all power, strength, and wisdom. It enables you to reject the power of externals, takes the burden off your shoulders, sets you on the high road to peace of mind, health, and happiness. The Lord is the presence of God, the I Am within you, given to you in the third of Exodus. The Lord is your own consciousness, your own awareness, your own life principle. Your state of consciousness, the way you think, feel, believe, and the reasoning behind your belief. God in the midst of you is guiding you now. His peace fills your soul. God's love saturates your whole being. I am the Lord that healeth thee. I am the Lord thy God. I will come and heal thee. God be with you.